Good morning. Today is the first day of the Joint Conference Committee for the 2011-12 budget. Assemblymember Bob Blumenfield, and I'm honored to be chairing this year's Conference Committee. As is tradition, it goes between the Assembly and the Senate each year. Today we begin the budget process to reconcile this 2011-2012 budget. Before we get started, there are three points I want to make about the road ahead. First, I want to thank you all in advance for what needs to be a very short but intense conference committee process. I hope to resolve the issues before us within the next 6 days so that the budget package can be considered on the floor as early as the end of next week. The exhaustive pace of work will allow provisions of the budget to go before the voters in a June special election. I ask the conferees to devote their calendars so that we can stay on task and on schedule. As conference chair, I'll do my best to preside over the hearings that keep us moving forward and on point. Second, I have some good news. We face a historically low number of conference issues. Both houses, for the most part, adopted the governor's budget, leaving very little to reconcile in conference. When you actually look at it, the difference between the Senate and the Assembly compared to the overall budget is less than 0.3% of the budget. That's remarkably small. And the differences between either of our versions of the budget and the governor's version of the budget is less than 1%. In other words, the proposal, once reconciled between these two versions, will be 99% of what the governor has put forward, which is a remarkable accomplishment. And this reflects our acknowledgement of the leadership that the governor has brought to the executive, something that we have been hungry for and denied for many years. Although the agenda is not very long, there are some thorny and complicated issues that lay ahead in realignment and redevelopment, first and foremost. These issues will require substantial discussion. Third, my goal for the conference process is to provide a forum where budget solutions are raised for discussion that bring us to a two-thirds vote for the budget package before us. I'm willing to devote time to ideas that are not on the conference agenda released yesterday, but only those ideas that help close our budget gap. I want to know what it'll take to bring our Republican colleagues from no to yes. We need bipartisan cooperation to govern California, and we must display the courage to lead through the state's budget challenges together. The invitation goes out not just to my Republican colleagues here on the dais, but to all of the Republican colleagues in the Assembly and the Senate. We all came here to serve our fellow Californians. The duty we share demands some very tough budget solutions that none of us would normally support and take no pleasure in supporting now. Solutions that would previously be in many ways unthinkable. Solutions that, if they weren't part of a balanced approach, could even be unconscionable. But these solutions are necessary, and we must have the courage to act. That is the price of leadership today. We have before us a plan to adopt some very tough cuts and to ask the voters to extend current taxes to solve California's budget deficit once and for all. We can end the difficult time in our state history together. So together, let us lead. I'd like to open it up for other members, starting with the Vice Chair, Mr. Leno, for opening comments, and I'll ask each member. Mr. Leno.
Thank you. Thank you, Assemblyman Blumenfield. And pleased to be with you for your chairing this conference committee. I think for all of us who have sat on the budget committees of each house over these past many weeks, that has probably been the most daunting, challenging, painful, and sobering experience any of us have had. I know for myself, this being my ninth budget season in the Capitol. The LAO had projected as recently as 2007-08 that our revenues for 11-12 would be $125 billion. As we know, they make projections for out years as a part of every budget year process. So if things had gone according to plan, if the economy had not tanked through an international fiscal crisis, we'd be at about $125 billion. We are, in fact, closer to $84 billion. A third of our revenue having evaporated in recent years. So it's been our challenge in the midst of this severe revenue problem, to adjust statutory required spending down to that $84 billion level. And as a result, many programs that Californians depend upon, from K through 12 education, though the governor has proposed sparing it in this 11-12 budget, higher education, of course, our social safety net and health care programs, public safety, everything is under consideration for significant reduction because the money just is not there. On the Senate side, we had taken actions on Friday after 3 days of budget committee hearings following the many intense weeks of budget subcommittee hearings, $12 billion in cuts, $12.5 billion in revenue, and approximately $3 billion in other solutions, getting to the $27.5 billion figure that the governor had put before us. We know that there are probably some other cuts we'll need to make to get those numbers up just a little bit. And that's where the sobering aspect of this comes into play. I do want to point out, though, that state spending as a share of the state's economy has declined in recent years and would drop even further under Governor Brown's proposal, whereas in Governor Duke Majan's 2000-2001 budget, the state spending as a share of the state's economy was 6.7%. Under the proposed 11-12 Brown budget, it would drop to 5%. So we are spending at historic low levels, again, making our challenges even greater as to how to do that most equitably, most fairly, and without destroying the infrastructure of the state of California that has allowed it to become the eighth largest economy in the world. So, Chairman Blumenfield, I know we've got some tough choices ahead of us, but as you pointed out, the good news is that the two houses' budgets are about as aligned as they've ever been, and we'll need to move quickly because with the governor's proposal to call for a special election in June, we as a legislature will have to take action on our floors by the first week in March to get those tax maintenance measures to a ballot at that time, and I think we'll be able to do that.
Thank you, Mr. Leno. Thank you, Mr. Leno. Next, the Vice Chair of the Assembly Budget Committee has a few opening remarks. Mr. Nielsen.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I'm honored to be serving under such an august body with some very fine members. And I can certainly promise bipartisan cooperation. At this point in our deliberations, I certainly would not promise any bipartisan votes, but I can bipartisan cooperation and problem solving for sure. I will be suggesting some changes, though, in how we do our budgets. It disturbs me enormously as to what we've come to, and I don't blame anybody. I think it's just been an expedient habit that's developed over several years, maybe a decade, maybe more. But it just does not suit me, and I could use stronger words, that we're dealing with spot bills, and we have no idea what's in them. And we've got this absolute profusion of trailer bills, all of which become mini budgets and entire negotiations in themselves, and some members can run their whole legislative program in a trailer bill. I think we need to maybe address that in our budget this year in some enduring way. And, you know, Senator Leno, whom I respect so much, has spoken to, yes, as a percentage of the state economy, the state government is a little smaller, and that's the proper trend. I think we need to build that in prospectively, too, because notwithstanding what we are not now spending, which you could characterize as not now spending or having been cuts, you ask any citizen their relationship with the agency, their favorite agency, DMV, Water Board, you name it, I think they will say that those boards are no less intrusive or onerous or in their way. Businesses would say the same, and this is a time to constrain and limit and say whoa to the growth of those agencies. Particularly in the regulatory process, and in that process, particularly the underground regulations or government by memo that doesn't even have statutory or regulatory backing. Good steps forward were made in pension reform in our October votes, and I think we need to examine that further. There probably could be some more things that we can do here to get pensions in alignment and in a more reasonable and responsible way than what we have evolved. I've mentioned the regulations. I've mentioned the and realignment. This is very disturbing, and I know we're going to have a great discussion on realignment, but the realignment discussion must begin with the discussion of mandates. Whatever we realign, it must be unfettered of the mandates that oppress local government that oblige them. We must not simply shift the state's problems, as has been the historic case, to local government. And I look forward to that. And I don't find any comfort in the idea of bifurcation. In other words, saying, well, we'll do these other things later. We'll work them out later. That, in the old phrase, is a pig in a poke, and no one should ever buy into the pig in the poke, particularly when it deals with government. Government has historically, particularly state, not kept its promises to local government. So I would say that we need to resolve it all as one fell swoop, not put something before the voters, realigning, and then we will work it out later. I think that's a dangerous precedent. I do look forward to rolling up our sleeves and working with Mr. Chairman, and it is a pleasure indeed working with you.
Thank you, sir. Next, the Vice Chair of the Senate Budget Committee, Senator Huff.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Well, our time to do conferences shifted up on the calendar a year a little bit, and that's a good thing in that, you know, we are in certainly a significant budget pressure. I applaud the governor for outlining a process that helps us deal with it quickly. But where I do take exception with that and what we've been doing in committee is it continues to be called this balanced approach. And from the best of my perspective, I can't find where the balance is. We have, it's called half cuts, half revenues, and we're really looking at $8 billion of cuts for the governor's proposal, $14 billion of revenues, $6.5 billion in shifts. And then in committee action, the Assembly, well, first of all, the Senate, backed away from $1.4 billion of the governor's cuts. The Assembly actually a little bit more, and then they backfilled with some one-time money, some borrowing and other things to get to a point that the chairman is now calling statistically insignificant or something. It's still a big chunk of change, and I'm wondering, and I guess through the process, we'll figure out how that amount gets made up. But I am frustrated that throughout this whole process, we're looking at this deficit as if it is the problem. It is not the problem. It is a symptom of the problem. The problem is that we have grown an uncoordinated mess of a state machine that wants to spend money on the natural without any focus on how you create jobs that pay the taxes that support the services. And so when we start running out of that fuel that runs the engine, which is called tax money, we just go out and try to find more without fixing the problem of why this thing is not running efficiently and why we can't get to where we need to go on the revenues that are actually collected. So I wish we were also contemplating here the real underlying problem instead of just outsourcing our misery to the counties through a realignment that has yet to be fully baked. It keeps changing on the fly. Last time it took 6 months to do a realignment when we had bipartisan support. This time we're trying to come up with a framework within a month. And, you know, anything half-baked around here is generally not good to ingest. So I do look forward to the process. I wish we were able to participate more. The few suggestions we did give in our budget hearings fell on deaf ears. So, you know, we will be here. We will work as we can. But we don't have any hopes that the outcome as a minority party will change any more than it has in the past.
Thank you, Senator Huff. Are there any other members of the committee who wish to make an opening comment? Ms. Harkey.
Thank you. This is my first conference committee, but however, I believe it's my fifth or sixth, maybe even seventh budget, and I've been here 2 years. We are always told that this is the big sacrifice and that somehow this is going to heal all wounds and the state will be back on track. I welcome the input of a new governor and someone who seems to at least have a real direction. And coming from the other side of the aisle, I want you all to know I wish him well and I wish success because California cannot afford 4 more years of this. However, I believe this is a probably good first effort on this governor's part because, as was pointed out by a senior member of the Senate, this really is not a balance between cuts and or spending reductions and revenues. It is actually very, very lopsided. And I asked some questions in the committee about what we're actually borrowing. What's the total internal borrowings being proposed? How much is being proposed as deferrals? Because we've done those games before. What is the actual outside borrowing we anticipate at the end of this process? How much more debt are we piling onto our state to get through this balanced approach? How many new state positions are we adding here at the state level when, in fact, we are talking about, cutting back on cell phones, which I'm not sure who has those, and then we are taking trinkets or marketing materials away. These are all fine. It's nice to find the little pennies, but right now we are talking about billions that we are deferring and delaying, and I do think that we can make some additional state reductions. I will be offering suggestions as this goes forward for additional avenues of where we can reduce that the majority party may find to be a little less painful than what is being suggested. I do suggest that before we go to the people and shirk our responsibility up here to get a balanced approach, which we can do now in the House, we have a majority party budget approval from the people of California. Requires a 41 votes on the floor in the Assembly, and I believe 21 in the Senate. So I think if we could find an approach that actually we could get 41 votes for in the Assembly, we could probably get a whole lot more. And that's where I'd like to see this going. I'd like to see us start chipping away immediately at things that we can do to show good faith with the people of California before we go back and try to pick their pockets again. Because it didn't work 2 years ago, and I don't really see that this is getting us anywhere healed at the state level, although some reductions, I'll admit, maybe about $6-8 billion we've come up with. But, we do need to know what is permanent and what is actually going to be one time. And because it sounds like a continuation of the same song that I've heard for the past 5 or 6 budgets. So I look forward to contributing and offering other suggestions, and I know we all are operating in good faith and goodwill and are trying to move this state forward, and we really need to succeed here. We need to accomplish, what we're here for and get the people a balanced budget that we can work with. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other members for opening comments? If not, I'd like to ask the clerk to call the roll.
Blumenfield.
Blumenfield here.
Emerson.
Here.
Fuentes.
Here.
Harkey.
Here.
Huff.
Here.
Leno.
Here.
Lowenthal.
Here.
Negrete McLeod.
Here.
Nielsen.
Here.
Skinner.
Here.
All here.
Great. Quorum is present. We're all here. Before we get started, I want to go over some housekeeping and procedural points that'll help us work our way through this. First, we've structured the conference agenda to meet the need to act quickly and transparently. We have two documents in front of you, two agendas. One is called the Major Issues Agenda. It's a regular conference agenda. Is the second one. The reason why I asked for the creation of a Major Issues Agenda was so that we could focus discussion on the bigger challenges that we face, like redevelopment and realignment. I hope this new structure helps our time management and decision-making go more smoothly. Second, I want to remind all members about some of the basic conference committee rules that have been in place for a long time. Only members of the conference committee, their staff, and the four legislative leaders are allowed on the dais during the hearing. Other members may attend, but they will sit in the audience. Second rule is, as is customary in the conference committee, there will not be time devoted to public comments. We expect only the Department of Finance and the LAO to be testifying. Rule 3, after each conference committee hearing, we really need to clear the room so that the staff can reconcile the differences. This is an important step to make sure that our actions are taken down correctly. It's not just to get rid of us, but to make it all work. As for our schedule, it's going to require all of us to really commit our schedules in this next short period of time. After we receive the overview from the LAO and the Department of Finance about the issues before us, we're going to try to get as much of that done between now and noon. If we don't complete that, we have an opportunity to take it up again in the afternoon after the Joint Legislative Budget Committee, which is scheduled to start at 1:30. That'll probably go for an hour. So if we don't finish by noon, we'll have a chance at around 2:30 to reconvene. Tomorrow, the intention is to continue the discussion of the major issues and begin to start on the regular agenda with some breaks interspersed to allow for staff briefings of the members of the upcoming issues. My hope is that we can complete a first pass of all of the issues by Friday afternoon. And for sort of the new members of the conference committee, the first pass generally, we're not going to make we're going to make some votes and tough decisions that are more consensus oriented, but really still try to work out the details. And then on the second pass, we'll really have to focus on, if we don't have agreement, coming to a vote. Other minor thing, just in the way I usually operate committees, just if you have a question or a follow-up, just shoot me a look or one finger, or if you have a follow-up question, just give me two fingers, and I'll try to bring you right into the next question for sort of a surgical strike comment or question, and that way I can keep everything moving along. So now let's formally begin the process, and I'd like to ask the LAO and
Mr.
Department
Chairman,
of Finance.
Quick question on that point, and I'll try to use the correct
don't ask
finger.
Me, don't ask
I'm
me which
signaling.
Finger, yes. I realized that as it came out. I probably should have said it that way.
Just saying. But I'd also request.
This is the one finger, yes.
Oh, okay, the pointer finger.
Yes,
yeah.
Yes.
When it comes to some of us have to travel. You know, we don't know we're on call on the weekend, as I understand. Could we just get some kind of notice in time so we make travel arrangements that airlines are running fewer flights, it becomes more problematic. So as soon as you have some indication, if we could know. And then also, we obviously need time for briefing as well. So just as crisply as we can get the schedule out, that would really help us, as I'm sure it does your own team members.
Absolutely. And toward that end, you communicate with us if there are issues that we need to work around. Okay. Let us know if there, and we'll keep as open and transparent about the scheduling. And my hope is that we can get through everything first pass by Friday, and really do the behind-the-scenes kind of work over the weekend and not come back in formally in terms of a conference committee until Monday. So that's my intention in terms of how we can roll this out.
Obviously. Is there a target date we're trying to finish the complete process?
Well, there's the physical date of the 10th is when the governor needs to have that bill signed in order to get it onto the ballot. And so sort of work backwards from there. We need to finish up our conference committee process by next week.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. So if I could ask Mr. Taylor and Mr. Cohen to come forward and any other finance or LAO folks. And again, we're basically going to start with an overview. We'll have some questions and discussion about the overview. Then we'll move to the realignment issues, some discussion and questions about realignment, revenues, and then finally, for today, the last issue we'll take up is redevelopment. So sort of keep the questions categorized in that fashion. So let's begin with the overview. Mr. Cohen, if you would begin and introduce yourself.
Sure. Thank you, Mr. Chair. Members, Michael Cohen with the Department of Finance. Just a few high-level comments before we get into more specific issues. First of all, I do want to acknowledge the significant amount of progress that has been made in a very short amount of time. We understand that you've had to compress your review of our proposals and that there's been some details that we've been still working out as you've been working through the issues, and we thank you for your patience for that, and also getting us here so quickly so that we can meet the timeline that the governor's laid out in terms of a package by early March so that we can move to a June special election. In addition, both houses have maintained the governor's balanced approach in putting forward a budget proposal. The framework in terms of roughly equal cuts in revenues has been maintained, and we appreciate that. Just to go ahead and comment on Mr. Huff's point that some of these cuts show up in the budget as shifts, those would be things like the redevelopment proposal that we'll talk about in a little bit, Proposition 10, Proposition 63. As I'm sure you've heard from various redevelopment agencies, what we're proposing is a real cut to redevelopment. There will be programmatic impact to mental health services, to children's services from our proposals. Those are cuts to services, albeit necessary ones, given our budget situation. Clearly, there is some additional work to be done, and that's why the conference committee is here, just to go over some of those key components that were in the governor's budget that we're looking for the legislative budget to move towards. First is the size of the reserve. The governor's budget had a reserve of nearly $1 billion, and that's given all of the risks inherent in a budget package this size. We think that's still the appropriate target. The Senate coming into conference committee has a reserve of $598 million, the Assembly $302 million. So we think we're within striking distance of go ahead and find some additional savings so that we can get up to that billion-dollar level. In terms of specific program areas, as your major issues agenda points out, IHSS, CalWORKs, childcare are really three of the big areas where we think you know, we still have a little bit of work to do in getting on, to the same place as the legislature. A second key point of the governor's budget that we need to maintain is that the solutions were real and obtainable, making sure that all of the things put forward can achieve the amounts that have been scored so that we're not back here in several months' time revisiting holes in our budget that haven't come to fruition. And finally, as you all know, rather than simply focusing on the 2011-12 budget, as has been routine in recent years, just looking at the upcoming budget, the governor's budget really looks over the long term and has an interest in bringing our budget into balance, not just for 2011-12, but also the 3 years following through 2014-15. The governor's budget was able to meet that target in terms of bringing forward to the voters a balanced four-year plan, and that's still an important goal for the administration. So with that, let me just say that we look forward to working with you, and thank you for getting us here.
Thank you very much, Mr. Cohen. Mr. Taylor.
Mac Taylor of the Analyst's Office. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members. I'll be very brief. This is an unusual conference committee. We're usually meeting in early June, not late February. And as you said, Mr. Chairman, there's really only a handful of kind of key issues in front of you. So it's a very focused kind of conference committee. I want to just highlight three areas. First of all, realignment. And Mr. Nielsen mentioned this in the issue of mandates. You don't have the language in front of you. You have key decisions that you either are going to have to make in conference committee or acknowledge that they'll have to be handled after you put the measure on the ballot. So that's kind of one of your key decisions on realignment. How much are you going to deal with now? How much will you leave for decision making after that measure has gone to the ballot? On redevelopment, both sides have taken the same level of savings that the governor proposed, but unclear as to the way that that would be achieved. I think the Senate is more in line with the governor's proposal in its detail, where the Assembly has been more, I think, open to achieving the savings in whatever way it can. So you have a really important decision with regard to redevelopment. And finally, usually Proposition 98 is a main point of contention in any conference committee. It's a key decision point because you have to kind of decide how much are you going to commit to 98, what's left over for the rest of the budget. That's not the case this year. Both sides have taken the level that the governor proposed, and you have only a few issues of dollar differences or language. Probably the key issue that you have within 98 is your child care package, where the two sides took different approaches, and they are different from what the governor proposed. So we'll obviously be helping you out and sorting through the differences there, but that's probably one of the most complex kind of packages, I think, that you have in front of you when it comes down to particular issues. So with that, Mr. Chairman, again, our staff are here to help you in whatever way we can.
Great. Thank you. We'll take a few questions on the overview, and then we'll dive into the substance. Mr. Huff, first question.
Yeah, on the overview, well, the Department of Finance said roughly equal. That's a little poetic license, I think. Nobody can score 1.7 of supposedly unspent money in redevelopment money as a cut to state. Yeah, it's a cut to them at local level, but it's being portrayed as somehow we up here are taking a balanced approach. And clearly, cutting them or sweeping in Prop 10 money or Prop 63 money, those are not cuts to state programs. And within that, I will frame it in that context so that there's no misunderstanding. But I have a quick question for the LAO. So I'm trying to read my notes, and it's almost as bad as trying to read fingers up here. But in the off years, I think originally you raised the question that, well, let me just put it this way. In the off years, how does the governor's budget look structurally?
In the out years?
In the out years, yes.
What the governor proposed?
Correct.
Well, in his document, and Mr. Cohen, of course, can speak to this, they felt like they had resolved the problem in the next 3 years is how far out they went.
And they characterized being balanced in the out years, but I think you had a difference of opinion on that, as I recall.
I think we felt like it made great progress in resolving our out-year problems if you adopted everything. However, we felt that there were so many proposals that there were some inherent risk in almost everything that you did that we felt that you were probably going to be left with some small problem, even if you adopted everything. But again, it made major progress in addressing the out-year problem.
I think I heard you characterize it somewhere as perhaps about a $4 billion problem out of whack in the out-years.
Well, I don't think I said a particular number. It could be in the low billions, again, depending on what went right, what went wrong.
Well, let me ask an easier question then.
Sure.
With the action taken in the Assembly and the Senate last year, does that help or hurt the out-year problem?
The actions taken by the two houses?
Correct, in our respective budgets that have led to this conference committee.
It's in some cases, it's hard to answer because we don't know if some of the actions they took were one-time or ongoing. So we'd have to kind of get some clarification from the two staffs on what they intended. I would tend to think that would probably make it a little worse, though, because there were clearly some one-time actions that were substituted for ongoing. I don't know how much.
Okay, you haven't quantified that yet.
No,
at what point will you be able to do
Well, in part, we would need clarification first on the actions themselves as we go through. That would help because then we could peg them as either one-time or ongoing.
Do you have any mechanism to seek that clarification?
Well, I think as we go through, that certainly the members can help make it clear as to what the action is that they're adopting.
Okay, well, if the legislative analyst doesn't know, I am concerned. Thank you.
Any additional? Ms. Harkin.
I would like to ask the Department of Finance. We have a scoring mechanism in place for the budget, I imagine. Now, on the conference committee, it appears that they're pretty close to what the governor. So do you know what is scored as one-time cuts and what is scored as permanent? Do you have a number on that?
We don't at this point, but we're happy to try to get back to you with a specific number. As Mr. Taylor mentioned, it would take a little bit of work, but we're happy to work on that for you.
Okay. I asked at the last budget committee that we had what was the total internal borrowing? Do you have that figure?
Sure. We've plugged in about $300 million of internal borrowing costs into our budget, and that's based on the $10 billion RAN that we've plugged in as a placeholder in terms of the cash flow borrowing. As we've seen from the last several years, the specific amount of borrowing won't be known for some time. First, it's going to depend on the package of solutions, when the timing of those solutions bring benefit to the state budget, so that can change the number a little bit. And then, obviously, we won't know until we go out to the market in terms of how much we can get and at what interest rate. But right now, the governor's budget assumes roughly $300 million in borrowing costs.
That's in debt service costs, right. The internal borrowing between accounts, are we taking more? I think we had about 719 as of last year. Are we allocating more internal accounts for borrowing? this year?
In terms of the outstanding loans, yes, we're increasing those. The governor's budget itself had almost $2 billion of new special fund loans or extending existing loans. In addition, when we proposed to abandon the sale-leaseback sale, our major piece of that was adding about another $900 million of similar types of things. So we are unfortunately adding special fund borrowing in this budget, but particularly when you focus that borrowing, which will be paid back over the next 2 years or so, compared to the multi-decade cost of the sale leaseback at a much lower interest rate, our proposal, we thought it was a slam dunk in terms of the fiscal choices there.
Okay. We need to go to market for Iran, right? And I believe we have to have a budget in place by June 30th, a solid budget, or maybe even before, which you can answer. By waiting for a June election, aren't we putting the state at risk of running out of money? What point do we run out of cash? Because the RAND is because we can't fund it internally, can't fund our debt internally, or our payments, I should say, internally.
Right. The specific time that we run out of cash, which really is more an incremental process than a particular day where the controller just goes into the Treasury and there's nothing there, will depend on a few different things. One will be tax receipts over the next few months. In addition, the package of solutions that are adopted and how quickly those generate cash solutions. So obviously the election is until the voters successfully approve a constitutional amendment, there's risk there, absolutely. And that's one of the reasons why the governor has said the actual budget bill won't be signed until we know for sure what happens with that constitutional amendment. And if it fails, we'll have some very serious work to do in a very compressed timeline.
Okay. Well, being a Department of Finance, I know that you run cash flows, and so you do actually have, because I've seen them before. I didn't request them right now, but I do. I would like to see your cash flows for this year, and with and without the tax increases that you're going to be going to the voters for, because I know you've got to have those.
Sure. And what we do at the Department of Finance are monthly cash flow estimates, and there are some variations within the month, which the controller tends to track. But we're happy to make sure that you have the monthlies that we prepare, and we can pull out the effects of the tax extension.
And a full year projection from then on. Current and then full year.
Current and budget year, sure.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Harkey. Mr. Nielsen.
Mr. Taylor, the extension of the taxes, or the increase in the taxes, how you could characterize it, is going to be for 5 years. But it looks like some 40% plus of the cuts are only 1 year. Is that roughly correct? In other words, I'm looking at the impact of long-term taxes but short-term cuts that will complicate our situation further in the future.
Well, again, it's hard to give you a total. I think what Senator Huff had referenced, maybe around $8 billion in ongoing cuts at state level, that sounds about right when we had done this, that kind of looked at that issue earlier. The changes made by the two houses, I don't know what it does to that number. Might reduce it a little bit. So you do have those permanent reductions, and you have the temporary tax increases.
But I think, I guess what I'm offering is that I would perceive, and we would argue that it's a $14 billion tax increase over those 5 years, and if you have $8 billion in reductions, then you're not plugging the hole. You're leaving a big leak in the hole. So I think that's a concern.
Well, and again, when we looked at it in January, we looked at permanent solutions, which I think at the time we thought it was about 8.5 on the expenditure side. And then you also have some permanent revenue increases. Remember, you have the single sales factor in the and the enterprise zones. So I think what we thought it was about 10.5 billion in permanent solutions in the governor's budget, of which they were primarily expenditure reductions.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you. Last one then. When, as I remember the analysis, or I believe it came from Ledge Analyst, as to the impact of the tax increase extensions on the decisions, and this would be 2 years ago, of the California citizens or companies, as far as what would, the, would those taxes discourage their spending and investing and really help get the economy back on track, would that be a counter? And I think it was suggested then that in that it was temporary, only 2 years, then that probably wouldn't be a big problem. But now we're looking at 7 years. Would that not then present a problem for Californians in looking at what they would do with their money prospectively?
Well, I'm not sure I characterize it necessarily as a problem as much as what you're raising is, do those longer-term tax increases have a greater effect on taxpayer decision-making?
That's exactly the
And I think the answer is, well, yes, it will have a greater effect because businesses now have to gauge in their time frame of making investments or hiring or whatever that these taxes will be in effect for a longer period of time. So it's hard to know what that impact is, but certainly is greater the longer the temporary taxes are in effect. They start looking more like permanent increases.
Thank you, Mr. Taylor.
I wanted to ask a follow-up based on some of the questions I'm hearing. When the taxes are characterized as $14 billion versus the $12.5 billion, what is, in essence, as I understand, when you're going to that number, what you're including is the Prop 98 $3.3 billion. Now, if you're going to do an apples-to-apples comparison, and the Department of Finance, I think, rightly did not include that in there, but if you're going to include that $3.3 billion in on the tax side of the equation, then you have to have an apples-to-apples, as I understand, and there's a question in here. You have to include that in on the revenues, on the cut side of it, because the cuts to education are not listed as a cut because it's just leveling it out to the Prop 98 level. But in fact, if you look at the education slope of the line, the program there is a programmatic cut of about that $3.3 billion. So could you sort of make the apples-to-apples comparison? If you're going to include the $98 on the one side of the equation, what does that do to the other side of the equation vis-a-vis the real cuts to programmatic spending in education and Prop 98?
Sure. Obviously, there are lots of different ways that you can cut these numbers. The reason that we have been using $12 billion in revenues is from a balancing the budget perspective. The various revenue proposals help balance the state budget by $12 billion, that there is $14 billion of revenues paid. However, if not for that, we wouldn't have $2 billion of Proposition 98 costs, so that when revenues go up, our Proposition 98 costs go up by the $2 billion, and so you end up with a net of $12 billion of benefit. Now, on Proposition 98, this is a longstanding debate in terms of how should we be projecting the workload budget in terms of should we be using, if we did nothing, the growth of the number of students as well as COLAs as the projected cost, or should we be just projecting the minimum guarantee, which tends to be the level that the legislature and the governor fund at. And it's consistent with past practice that both the Department of Finance and the LAO have been using the minimum guarantee, which means that from a balancing the budget perspective, if you maintain that the minimum guarantee, you're not adding solutions. However, as the chair mentioned, that in order to fit within the minimum guarantee, there are some serious reduction proposals within the Proposition 98 group. Child care, we're proposing $716 million of cuts to child care, $400 million to community colleges, as well as the K-12 deferral. So it's really, this debate gets down to the way both the LAO and the Department of Finance figure out what would the problem be if no action was taken. It's consistent with the way we've been doing this the last several years, but it obviously lets you depending on how you want to think about solving the budget, you can run the numbers one way or the other. The bottom line is that at the end of the day, you have to take a package of solutions that's the governor's budget or something very similar to it, so that when all is said and done, you have close to a $1 billion reserve, and that's the most important thing, that we get to a balanced budget, regardless of how we're calculating the numbers.
Yeah, and those are real cuts, in essence, that, I mean, whether they get considered cuts or not, those are real cuts that affect real people. Mr. Leno, you have a comment.
Sure. Thank you. I think some of the conversation we've been having is trying to get to a greater understanding at a greater perspective of how we got into this situation, and there have been questions about ongoing cuts, temporary tax measures. Mr. Taylor, could you remind us of the many ongoing tax cuts or credits that we have put in place in recent years that are ongoing exacerbating components of the imbalance in our budget? For example, I'm thinking of one would be the rescission of the restoration of the vehicle license fee, I think now costing the state annually, short of the temporary uptick, approximately $6 billion. That's an ongoing cut hole in our bucket that we've never replaced. We've attempted to address it with a temporary two-year, which was put in place by the legislature, of course, that now sunsetting. But the $6 billion continues to be ongoing. I'm thinking also of the single sales factor. That was a permanent $1 billion additional hole in our bucket. The corporate tax sharing also is, what, about $350 million ongoing hole in our bucket. Part of the problem here is that we continue to cut our revenues and don't replace them with equally permanent revenues, and that's part of our problem.
Well, we certainly have. You have taken actions in recent years to provide tax relief. The VLF was an interesting one in that the tax relief was provided, and it shows up as a state expenditure because it's reflected in higher school spending because we, in effect, bought out, you know, property taxes. You also, before you lowered it in the 2 years ago, you had increased the dependent exemption credit, which was a large form of tax relief. By increasing it, like tripling it from its level that it was. So you have taken
that one back to about 1999. It was supposedly a good times tax benefit at the height of the dot-com boom.
Yes, and so it was a quick and easy way to get relief, particularly to families, and that's you decided to triple, in effect, the dependent exemption credit for claims for children, basically, which was a big benefit, particularly to middle-income people. So you have taken some actions, both on the corporate and on the PIT side, to provide a targeted tax relief.
And those have been ongoing?
There have been ongoing, and it's, again, some you have, in the case of the dependent exemption credit, you took action 2 years ago, right. But some have been ongoing.
Thank you.
I'm going to go to Mr. Huff for a follow-up. Before I do, just remind members that the second issue we have is all about the revenue. So we're still on the overview section. Obviously, revenues are part of that, but know that we're going to have time to delve into the revenues. Mr. Huff.
It seems germane now since we're talking about it, and it is part of the overview. On the Prop 98, I think it's, you know, I'm hearing a lot of semantics, but the reality is we have to raise 14 to solve a $12 billion just because of the way that Prop 98 is when you're scoring 40% that goes back. And similarly, when we talk about a $26.4 billion problem, that includes a $1 billion reserve, but we have to solve it at a $28.4 billion level. It's just the Department of Finance has put $2 billion in little brackets and then talks about only the net. So just as far as transparency, we choose to message 14 billion taxes instead of 12 because that's the truth, and it's a 28.4 billion solution to get the 26.4 billion level that we have to have. Mr. Taylor, I had to get this document because I was starting to worry about my recollection. But on Figure 4, you had listed, or your office did, the multi-year Big Three general fund revenue forecasts, and you had your forecast going in the out years 2014-15 at 101.258 in Department of Finance at 105.045, and there's a similar $4 billion the year before as well. So I would take that to be a $4 billion structural problem in the out years from your estimate, which is based on assumptions as well as the Department of Finance's assumptions. But that's, I think, where I was going on that.
I'm sorry, Senator Huff. That's the $4 billion referred to?
Yes.
Okay. Because when we had made an estimate of what the budget might have addressed in the out-year problem was talking about a little different situation. So I appreciate where the source of the number is.
Thank you. And let me lob one more question to you because we haven't addressed this. This package that we're looking at presumes that the voters will approve a tax package that, you know, call it whatever you want. What happens to the underlying general fund expenditures during that five-year period? Do they grow, and if so, by how much?
Well, the costs that we're shifting to locals?
No, just overall the general fund spending for the state.
Oh, well, I guess the last time we would have looked at that would have been in November. Jason?
Finance, you have that?
Sure. Our number, obviously, based on our revenue forecast, we had expenditures at $84.6 billion in the governor's budget in 2011-12, growing over time to $111 billion in 2014-15.
So that's about a $25 billion increase during the time of this extension, or somewhere around 30%. Increase.
Right, and the major contributors to that growth are going to be one is Proposition 98. So as our revenues rebound, in addition to the normal sense that Proposition 98 will get a share of the revenues, in addition, as you know, we have a very large maintenance factor, which increases the rate of growth there. The other major program growing fast would be the Medi-Cal program due to two primary reasons. One, just the general rate of health care inflation, and two, the costs of federal health care reform on the state budget by the time we get out to 2014-15.
Yeah. Mr. Taylor, you concur with roughly?
It sounds about right.
Okay. That's good enough. The only reason I bring that up is because when we portray this thing, we sort of portray the image that, first of all, it's balanced, and I've articulated my reasons why I think it's not balanced between revenues and reductions. And then we also get the image that somehow we've got this austere program going through, and it will be in some areas. But in the meantime, we've still got inflators that are growing our general fund by almost 33% during the 5 years that we would have these taxes extended, and we have no end game. We don't have a plan B. What happens when those taxes expire, unless I'm missing something? And it just means that either the economy's rebounded to the level that it can then again take over and support the level of spending we've got, or we're back in another situation like this with a new legislature, you know, solving this problem once again, because there again, we haven't gone after the structural issues that drive our budget.
Mr. Fuentes.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I was struck by something that Assembly Member Harkey sort of mentioned in terms of before we go out to the voters and make our case, and I think this conversation is a very good one, talking about the balance between the expenditures and the and sort of the revenues. I wanted, and I recognize what I'm about to say is probably convenient, so I'll just attribute it to myself, but the unspoken cuts that sort of you've mentioned in Prop 98, the difference between sort of what we have, again, I'll say myself, conveniently accepted to be minimum guarantees versus actually workload sort of type funding. I recognize that that's probably very convenient in previous sort of budget years to make sure that we're in balance. And I think Ms. Harkey is absolutely correct. When we go to the voters and we make the case, I think, again, very convenient, we should probably talk about what sort of the unspoken cuts have been to education by virtue of looking at the comparison of the sort of workload budgeting that's necessary or that should have been there versus sort of the minimum guarantees that we've accepted. And I'm wondering if there's analysis or some numbers that you can help us sort of understand what that difference is, because I think that's something that helps to promote the conversation about balance between what we've done historically and what we're asking the voters to do now, because I think that number helps demonstrate sort of the additional cuts, unspoken cuts, that have taken place and why we need to sort of go to voters for for permission, and I'm just wondering if you can help us sort of understand historically what those numbers would have been and where we sort of are today in terms of those cuts, because we've done all sorts of additional things and deferrals and a lot of debate, I think, with the previous administration as to what was owed and what's not. And I think that tally is important to sort of balance the revenues that we're asking for and match those with the cuts that I believe we've already sort of proposed and maybe have not spoken about.
Sure. The easiest and most simple way to think about the amount of funding for education is in 2007-08, we were providing $57 billion through the Proposition 98 minimum guarantee. Without the tax extensions, the minimum guarantee would be down at $47 billion. We're proposing to, when taking the whole package together, we're proposing a spending level of $49.3 billion. So while we've made K-12 education a funding priority within this budget, it's still a dramatically lower level than schools were funded at just a few years ago. In terms of
That's using the rubric of sort of a minimum guarantee sort of accounting for the cuts. I mean, if you were to sort of look at what the workload should be at, I mean, if we were to accept those numbers, they'd be significantly higher numbers, would they not?
That's right. Another way to, on revenue limits, the general purpose, money available to schools, there's what's known as a deficit factor, kind of the amount that we're short of that level, and it's in the range of about 20%, so that we're roughly 20% below what's commonly understood to be the workload funding level. Even beyond that, we've made reductions to the categorical programs, along with that, we've given schools more flexibility, but still there's considerably less money flowing to school districts.
Thank you.
Can you repeat
Ms. Skinner, go ahead.
Can you repeat those numbers that in I got the 27.8 57 billion figure, but you mentioned
right. So under if we did nothing and didn't extend the taxes, we'd be down at $47 billion under the governor's budget, as well as the two budgets that are before you from the Assembly and the Senate, $49.3 billion.
And that's compared to our funding level that we adopted in October for 10-11 was about 49. Correct?
Exactly. And so that's been the notion underlying the governor's budget, is that by extending the taxes, we're able to at least maintain the same level of funding as available in the current year. Otherwise, we'd be dealing with an even additional drop.
So it's the same level, but we could have more students. We could have, so it's not actually, or it's potentially not equivalent to the same
right.
expenditure
There are costs going up within Proposition 98, and that's one of the things we've had to deal with. On the K-12 side of things, we are keeping programmatic funding per pupil within state and local Proposition 98 resources at roughly the same level. But because of the cost increases and the various one-time measures that were used in the current year budget, that's what necessitates the really tough cuts in community colleges and child care.
When you say per pupil the same level, you're saying with the revenues. If we don't have the revenues, then as I understand it, per pupil expenditure can go down by $1,000 a pupil. Is that correct?
I don't have the number in front of me, but yes, without the extra revenues, we wouldn't be able to maintain the same level of per pupil funding.
So it underscores the question, if there's ever a question of whether or not there are cuts involved here, when we're trying to define what are the 98 cuts, if the status quo means $1,000 less per pupil, it's hard to categorize that as anything other than a cut. Ms. Harkey, you had a follow-up question.
Yes, I did. Just a quick follow-up question. It would seem to me, and I am not an education expert, don't claim to be on the funding. I'm trying to get my hands around it, but it seems to be so arcane and been changed over the years. But the Prop 98 has the same problem as our state does, that when the taxes are going up, they continue to spend, and we continue to ratchet up the guarantee. And what exacerbates that situation is, in fact, that governors, when there's extra money, like to overfund Prop 98. Now, I know a couple years ago we had a suspension, and so we owe some money back funding. And so it seems like we're in this little spiral with Prop 98. There's no doubt that it's been reduced, but is there any mechanism, or would we need a reform mechanism for Prop 98 to, in fact, allow a reserve in good times so that we wouldn't be reducing in bad times?
In terms of funding, the Constitution does require a set amount of money to be spent each year. One of the problems we've had in Proposition 98 is changes within the year, and theoretically we could reserve a certain amount until we knew the final number, but there's no real mechanism in the Constitution now to under-appropriate the minimum guarantee on the notion that over the long term you're building up a reserve.
Okay, so that it just seems to me maybe this is an issue that we really need to look into, because I've been up here just a couple years, but it's amazing how, you know, and in fact also funding under Prop 98 is not distributed equally throughout the state. So while we protect Prop 98, and I'm all for protecting the education system and funding, it doesn't really help a lot of schools in my district or around my district. They are not beneficiaries of this. So I think there's some issues here with Prop 98 that maybe we need to explore and could do at a later date and see if we can't allow for some kind of a reserve policy there. Thank you.
Thank you. I think we're just about ready to move to the next issue. Although I had trouble resisting a comment on 98 in terms of the overfunding issue, because we're now 49th or 50th in the nation in per pupil spending. It would take us a while to get to the place where we're worried about overfunding our education if you're compared to the other states. It's just an observation. But if there are no other questions on the overview, I'd like to move on to the next major issue, which is public safety realignment. Members, this issue is to provide some framework on what the actions that we need today to implement the governor's public safety realignment. We're going to focus more of the details on Friday in terms of, so hopefully we're not going to get mired too much in all of the details, but sort of stay conceptual right now, because we really need to define the work that we have to do over these next couple of days. So let's start with finance. If you could give us an overview of the elements of the public safety realignment in the constitutional amendment, what are the elements in the realignment that are actually going to go to the Constitution? And start with that, but give us a sense of what the proposal is.
Please. Sure. As we've talked about at previous hearings, what would go before the voters is the extension of the existing tax rates on the personal income tax, the sales tax, and the vehicle license fee for 5 years. The personal income tax we can leave aside for the moment, because those revenues would be dedicated to education and meeting the state's Proposition 98 guarantee. So what the voters in terms of realignment would be faced with is a $5.9 billion package that would shift funding and responsibility of various public safety programs from the state to local governments, identifying which of those programs the realignment would cover. It would dedicate the $5.9 billion, the 1 cent sales tax, and the 0.5% VLF extension to funding those programs. Those tax revenues would be extended for 5 years, and within the Constitution, there would be a guarantee of an equivalent dollar amount going forward into the future. So the tax extension ending would be the state's responsibility to to deal with that issue, not local government's responsibility. And then finally, a major component of the language is sort of dealing with mandates, and in terms of when you're shifting this amount of money and programs between the state and local governments, our existing mandate system really doesn't work well. For the state, it doesn't work that well because you wouldn't want local governments to turn around and say, well, you've given me these programs and I want mandate reimbursements. But from a local government perspective, counties also need protection that we won't shift $5.9 billion worth of programs and then the next year say, oh, by the way, we'd like you within that pot of money to do these extra responsibilities of hundreds of millions or billions of dollars. So the way we view it within the constitutional amendment is that it's an even playing field, that counties can have some guarantee in terms of that they know what programs are being shifted to them, what their supply of money will be, and that going forward, any future changes, they would not be done unilaterally, that if the state was going to add additional requirements, the state would pay for those additional requirements outside of these tax revenues.
Thank you. Mr. Taylor.
Mr. Chairman, let me just make a couple comments, and my colleague, Marianne O'Malley, may have some additional ones that she'd like to make. You know, your first decision really is, are you comfortable with the realignment? Are you comfortable with the specific programs that are listed on page 2 of your agenda on these programs being realigned to locals? This is what the governor's proposed. We generally felt that these programs were deserving of consideration for realignment, with one exception. We thought the court's security was not a good choice at all. But otherwise, the programs make sense to us, although there are concerns. But that's really your first decision. Are these the programs that you feel comfortable sending down to counties and giving them greater responsibility over? Then I think you at least need to make that decision and letting voters know what is they're going to be responsible for at the local level. When you go to the next page of your staff's agenda, you get into a lot of the more difficult issues, particularly in number 5 of the other issues, about how much detail do you want to specify? And I would even go to the last bullet on that list. How much flexibility will counties have? And how will the funding be placed in separate pots? Or are you going to give counties control over, in effect, most of the money that's being sent to them? So you have that next level of decisions that you need to decide. Are you going to specify that in the constitutional amendment? Are you going to, how much are you going to defer to later on? Marianne?
The only thing I'd like to add, Marianne O'Malley at the analyst office, is you also need to give some thinking, some thought to the extent of program flexibility that you're going to be affording the counties in administering these programs. If a county is going to have a wide degree of flexibility, that suggests one thing in terms of the level of revenues that the county is going to need. If the county is going to be administering the program in the exact way that the administration, that the state currently administers the program, that suggests something different in terms of the level of revenues. So you need to have some thought regarding the size of the program that you're going to be realigning. Are these going to be people that are going to be in county jails for a very long period of time? And if so, that suggests a greater level of funding. Are these people that are going to be in county jail perhaps for a short period of time and then treated with a variety of mental health or substance abuse or community supervision, which suggests a different level of funding that would need to be provided?
Thank you. First question to Senator Negrete McLeod.
Mr. Taylor, why is it that you don't think the court security is one of the programs that should be shifted?
Under trial court realignment, the state has taken over control of the courts, both their operations and the capital facilities. It's ours that we realigned up instead of realigned down. To now say that you want to have the court security provided by a county separate from the decisions being made by the state doesn't make any sense at all to us.
except most of the security that is done in the courts comes from sheriffs, which are county.
Right, exactly. But we, in effect, require that. Okay. We actually have a kind of a monopoly that the sheriffs, we say that they will provide that. We could end that monopoly and decide to do it in a different way. The point is that's our decision as a state to have the county sheriffs do that. Our belief is that we should maintain control over security. We can still have the sheriffs do that. But to realign and say now it's the locals' responsibilities, we just don't understand that.
Okay. Mr. Leno.
Thank you. Notice in the agenda on page 2 that two of the larger line items, especially added together, lower level offenders, parole violators, along with realign adult parole, total about more than any other couple of lines. So this is an important issue area. And I want to talk about Mr. Taylor's concern about flexibility. I would be in favor of flexibility, but also I would just want to urge the administration, as you develop this proposal further, to make sure that we have real standards, that we speak to evidence-based programming, that we speak to results and to outcomes. And I want to make brief reference to the current implementation of the community corrections statute that this legislature put into place a couple years ago, along with the $40 million one-time federal funds that will kickstart this program. The whole idea being that we really want to make sure that the evidence-based programming and the incentive also to get the results, to lower recidivism rates, to lower failure rates for those who are on both parole and probation, do not evaporate, because we've made great progress there. And I wouldn't want to see these very significant billions of dollars of funds shifted and not have those same statutory incentives and standards and results put into place once we do the shift.
Sure. Let me start by making a broad comment about the state role in all of these programs. And I think your point is a good one in that the state role in a realigned world really should be focusing on outcomes and program evaluation to make sure that we're getting the outcomes and results that we desire, and making sure that counties have the tools to do that. In the corrections area specifically, the changes that have been made in the last few years are really at the core of the realignment to give us confidence that, in fact, we can do better at the local level and achieve better results rather than at the state level. So that's certainly an underpinning of the realignment proposal.
And I hope you're considering the kinds of incentives that we put into SB 678, our community corrections proposal.
We are.
So that there would be the incentive to share some of the savings the state will incur as we lower the population, as fewer and fewer parole and probation violators don't come to state prison, share that with the locals to continue the successful programming that have kept our crime rates lower, subsequently resulting in lower prison populations.
Right, and the incentives here are going to be perhaps even more dramatic in that every dollar that the counties can save in terms of not constantly incarcerating the same individuals will be available to them within the realignment pot for an additional public safety purpose.
Good. It sounds like we're on the same page here.
Absolutely. It's probably a good time for me to say that we have been hearing the discussions in legislative committees as well as from the various stakeholders, and we are planning on making some changes within the proposal. And so I'm staying a little bit away from the details. We're not quite ready to walk through those, but we will have those for you very shortly in terms of some modifications.
We'll keep an eye on it.
Okay.
Thanks.
Mr. Fuentes, followed by Mr. Nielsen.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I wanted to, Mr. Taylor sort of mentioned that this is sort of the host, the menu that we get to choose from in terms of sort of one of the fundamental decisions that this committee has to make. But as Ms. O'Malley mentioned, sort of program flexibility in terms of how we distribute the services and the allocation of the dollars. I'm just wondering if you could help me understand, amongst the items that are being proposed here, where are there potential issues with sort of compliance, either because we're hamstrung by block grant funding that we get? Are there areas here of concern in terms of making sure that we're in compliance in a realigned world?
Perhaps the most vivid example is in AB 3632 program. That is currently, that's a program whereby county mental health departments provide mental health services to special education pupils. Under the way this program currently works, a county must provide the level of services that are identified on the child's individual education plan. And counties must provide those services regardless of the cost. And the counties turn and submit those costs to the state for reimbursement. That's how it currently works. Under the administration's plan, as it is right now, there's a $104 million provided to the counties. And to our knowledge, there is no greater flexibility for the counties. Well, this amount of money isn't enough to run the program as it is currently structured. Now, it may be possible to revise the program to give counties some greater program flexibility, but as it is currently structured here, the existing program, which costs in the range of $250, $260 million a year, that level of funding isn't enough to maintain that existing program. You would have to give counties some flexibility to say, no, we're not going to provide all these level of services, or some of the responsibility is going to be shared with the schools, or give counties some flexibility to reduce the cost, unless you either have to reduce, increase the amount of money, or give counties greater flexibility.
Any other areas where there's federal money interplay with some of these services where there's potential compliance issues?
Oh, sure. On child welfare services, on the mental health programs, you have federal mandates. You have the changes with the federal health care law. I think those have raised concerns. Not that these programs don't have the potential to be better administered at the local level, but, for example, there's a statewide penalty under child welfare services. How do you impose a statewide penalty when the counties have responsibility for the program? How do you kind of aggregate up to what the individual counties do and have the state is still responsible? So there are clearly issues involved with federal requirements and rules.
Recognizing that we'll be getting into more detail on Friday, how do you sort of reconcile those sort of challenges? I mean, I imagine that you all have sort of attempted to sort of think of a governance structure that would allow for the flexibility while protecting sort of the state's interests in terms of penalties and that sort of thing. Any ideas at this point that you'd like to share with us on how that construct would look?
Well, we've struggled, particularly in relationship to mental health, because this was one that was realigned back in 91, and so it conceptually makes sense to try to go further. In fact, you could have wrapped in Prop 63, the pro tems measure that was approved a few years back, and really put all the money together and have counties responsible for all that spending. We had to hesitate, though, because of the federal health care law, which is going to obviously create kind of statewide responsibilities in the out years. So at the time in which you have this kind of responsibilities elevating up to the state in the future, we're pushing some down to the local. It was a real tension for us because we saw potential, but we also concerned about those issues. So we don't have a good answer for you, Assemblyman.
Thank you.
Mr. Nielsen, followed by Ms. Harkey.
Of all the areas of realignment, this is the one of most grave concern. And it should be to the public, and it should be to the counties, and they should be really pushing back on all of this. I couldn't agree more that the locals can do most things better than the state can do. But in this very complicated area, you've got two imperatives. One is justice, the justice system, and two is public safety. And the individuals who will be now coming out into the counties. This can be a fundamental shift of what are now state responsibility inmates, parolees, and wards to becoming local responsibility inmates, parolees, and wards. And we must be very careful about the mandates. Regardless of the mandates, what local government it'll be required to do for and with this population, which they have not enough resources at all to deal with right now. And that's part of why this parole system for a long time has failed. But as these inmates gravitate, parolees and wards, they will be followed by the federal lawsuits and separate independent lawsuits that will come to visit our counties. The biggest out-of-control percentage cost, growth cost in corrections is litigation. And they certainly better be aware of that. This is an area where we should be proceeding very, very slowly, ladies and gentlemen. And this cannot be something that we enable the voters to realign this public safety area, and then we'll work out the details later. And Mr. Cohen, I think I know just a bit about this, and I certainly would like to be somewhat privy to or involved in some discussions. I'm happy to offer constructive suggestions, but if something is thrown in my lap, I will have no recourse but to fight it, based on all of the experience I have and the dangers that will come to visit the citizens of California. Whenever you change sentencing and parole policy in the state of California, you better do it with caution. 1977, the determinate sentence law was passed with conservatives and liberals both supporting it, all lived to rue the day of that massive change. We better be very careful here. This one is a go slow area of this budget.
Ms. Harkey, followed by Mr. Huff.
This is probably more of a question. Well, I guess it's a question for the DOF and maybe the LAO. But what is the rush to realign? Is this a political decision that sounds better to the voters that we realign immediately?
No, I hesitate to say that we're doing this in a rush. There has been discussion over a number of years regarding these programs about whether they make sense at the state level or at the local level, and our proposal is really building upon those years of discussions. But in terms of going to the voters, this is really a choice in terms of these are the programs that with the tax extensions, we have been able to protect in terms of not subjecting them to cuts. And without the tax extensions, we basically wouldn't be able to make that same commitment.
Okay, you're relying primarily on the tax extension, so this goes to my other question. Is there any legal problem with bringing forth the tax increase that you so desire? And continuing to operate these functions at the state level until such time we had a full realignment plan drawn up? Because you really, what you're trying to do is accomplish the goal of balancing the budget with additional taxes. Because whether you say it's realignment or you say it's divesting state, you need more taxes, which would normally come to the state. And I understand the Prop 98 considerations, which is why I'm asking this. Could you set up these same kind of allocations separately such that you would fund these programs, and then we could have a real discussion and really fleshing out before we just, voila, make it happen at the state level to fund these things as we need to do these programs, and then realign, which I'm for. I think it makes a lot of sense, but realign with some input and actually ensuring that it works. We have 58 counties. One size doesn't fit all for this state, and so, you know, we don't understand what the mandates are. So and the federal. So I think Mr. Fuentes pointed it out that we're entering this black hole, and so did Mr. Nielsen. So I'm wondering, could we just, and would the chair consider the tax increases if you want to get that part out, but save the realignment till we have a real plan?
Certainly the realignment is wrapping up various components of the governor's plan. It's clearly helping to balance the budget, but it's also about taking this opportunity to make government work better, and that's the realignment part of things. But in terms of getting the details right, what I described is the constitutional amendment that we do think needs to be settled now in order to get something on the ballot in a timely manner. But the details of exactly how the money is going to be allocated, what type of flexibility. We think that's on a second track in time for when the ballot measure passes. Those bills will have been considered and ready to go. But we are very sensitive to sort of doing this wrong and getting the details wrong, and that's why we think the framework makes sense now, and that over the next several months we would have more time to get into the details of constructing the program. But we have been meeting with the counties on a regular basis, having a dialogue, working through all the various issues, so that with several more months we think the details on those programs will be ready to go.
Well, I'm sorry. I just, you know, making the state. I think this is a very, very aggressive approach. I understand the need to plug the hole, and we have to do that. And I understand the need, or what you think is the need, to raise the taxes in order to plug that hole. I happen to disagree on that. But what really concerns me is the realigning without a really, really well thought out plan. And right now, with 2,000 some odd bills running through this House, I don't see the focus on it. And I think, you know, we will do a lot of harm at the state level. It won't run smoother, and we will not run smoother at the county levels. And so, and we've also got this clause that we will guarantee, or supposed to be on the ballot, that will guarantee ongoing revenues after 5 years to the counties. How can we guarantee that if right now we're taking redevelopment monies from our cities because we're plugging holes? How can we guarantee in 5 years? Do we have a projection, a long-term projection, that shows where we're going to be such that we can make this guarantee?
First off, I will grant you that this is aggressive. With a budget shortfall of the size that we have and the number of years that we haven't dealt with it, I think the current situation requires some aggressive action. In terms of what happens 5 years from now, and this gets back to Senator Huff's comment earlier, our first goal is obviously to get the economy recovering, and so that by the time we get 5 years down the road, the state revenues will be there to simply kind of ease this into our budget. I don't know, you know, we obviously, nobody knows to the extent that'll be the case. We go out 3 years past the budget year, LAO goes past 4 years, and even at the ends of those projections, obviously lots of things change and it's difficult to project. But if that's not the case in terms of the economy recovering, then you'll have a governor and a legislature who will have had 5 years to make additional adjustments, consider all of their choices. And if we're talking about finally having 5 years of stability, we'll be in a much, much better position to balance this piece of the budget, as opposed to the $20 billion problems we've been facing in recent years.
Thank you. Mr. Huff, followed by Mr. Emerson.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. On page 3, Mr. Cohen, there's a list of questions down there under 3, 4, 5, 6 questions. Do you have the answers to those?
I can speak to them generally now. And so in terms of realignment interacting with our current mandate process, the Constitution, we think, needs to sort of bring this a little bit outside of the current mandate process. As I mentioned earlier, that we don't want to realign these programs and then turn around and get a mandate claim for something we just realigned. But we also need to make changes in terms of counties getting protection from the state in terms of additional changes. So I guess I would say the mandate issue will be settled in the Constitution, but on a slightly different track than our current mandate process. I think that covers the second bullet. As well as the third bullet, same sort of commitment to counties that the state's not going to unilaterally enter into things that increase county costs. In terms of maintenance of effort, basically the Constitution will guarantee that all of these funds are spent on the public safety programs that are being realigned. In terms of current expenditures, that's an issue that we're working on. And in terms of figuring out a way to ensure that counties have the flexibility to continue to make budget choices, but make sure that this isn't just a mechanism to basically backfill their budgets. In terms of revenue changes, this is a package of revenues that would be given to counties, and they would be expected to handle these programs. We have yet to find a state revenue that we can guarantee is going to grow at a steady rate year after year, and so there's not much we can do about that. And then finally, in terms of the flexibility about moving money between programs, we think that falls into the allocation decision, which is more a June timeline process rather than right now, that we plan on working closely with the counties in terms of coming up with an allocation and a flexibility process that works for both the state and the local governments.
So do you have any of this written down in writing it?
We will have you language shortly on the constitutional amendment. I will grant you that we owe you that, and that it's an important piece, obviously.
That's a long way to say no.
At this point, no, but we will have it to you shortly.
Okay. As you may know, some of the stakeholders have some concerns. Counties, to my understanding, have not taken a position on this, but they certainly believe your revenue projections are optimistic. And that, of course, as you said, they're expected to implement the programs, and if they don't have the revenues there, that's going to, as I have often said, outsource our misery to them. The sheriffs are concerned about capacity and population shifts. It could leave them in a situation where they don't have enough time to develop the capacity at the local level. I think that's a very valid concern. DAs have serious concerns with the realignment proposal, convinced it'll have disastrous consequences on public safety, producing increased crime, more victims in every community across the state. Particularly because it's all predicated on tax increases that may or may not happen, in given the nature and the mood of the voters, probably not, and yet they will have their public safety held hostage to a vote without a determined outcome. And so I think these are all issues we should take to heart. Mr. Cohen, you made the comment we should hesitate to say we are in a rush. I don't think anybody's saying that anything other than we are in a rush. If we don't have details on some very simple things, you have major stakeholders with major issues, and you know, not to wear out a well-worn phrase, but this is sort of the wimpy realignment plan, and you know, we'll do this today and I'll pay you back Tuesday. There's no hamburgers in this. As I said before, you get something half-baked, it goes down pretty tough. And I think this is one that certainly is half-baked. Again, it took 6 months on realignment last time with a concerted effort. We're trying to do it in less than a month. Actually, we're trying to do it in a lot less time than this right now. So I certainly, I think all of us should have concerns. And I think the LAO phrased it well. Are we comfortable with the questions that we have broad brushstroke answers to with no language? I'm definitely not comfortable with it, and I certainly can't support it.
And just to, in terms of responding to the stakeholder concerns, that's a discussion. I think when we have our revisions for you shortly, you'll be able to see that we have been listening to them. Protecting public safety is clearly a top priority of the administration, and so I think you'll see that we have been hearing all of the comments, and the revisions will address those concerns.
Do we know what shortly means? Is there any quantification of that term?
Our hope is end of the week.
This week?
This week.
Okay. We'll be waiting with bated breath.
Thank you.
And we certainly will devote time to it on Friday when we have all the language. So I can at least promise you that. Mr. Lowenthal.
Yeah. I just need some understanding. This year, and it's just about the part of the realignment on mental health, the four mental health programs. This year, we're going to be using the zeros because we're going to be using Prop 63 funds. I believe in my last, and that's what I'm going to ask you, it was about $1 billion from Prop 63. Is that not correct?
$861 million.
And yet the following year we're talking about almost $2 billion. How do we do that? How do we go from $800 million funding it this year at the state level to then asking the counties to do almost $2 billion. How does that work?
Right. The key is the 861, the Proposition 63, are just the first three lines there. So EPSDT, Mental Health Managed Care, and AB 3632.
And that's
the last $1 billion is actually money that's already provided for under the 1991 realignment. And so that's money that will continue to be there in the upcoming budget year, and then we're proposing the change in 2012-13 to move that money into the pot. But
it's already there, though.
It's already there. It's already there. So mental health services will continue to have the same amount of money, absent the one-time loss of Proposition 63 dollars.
Okay.
Great. What I'd like to do now is, instead of going to item two, which was revenues, to jump to item three. We've touched a little bit on item two already, and I want to at least begin the discussion on redevelopment prior to our breaking, which I attended around noon, but maybe we can go to about 10 after noon, 10 minutes after the hour, at least to get that process started. So I'm going to ask Finance and LAO to discuss it, but also I'd like you to discuss not just the redevelopment proposal that was out there, but also to talk about the big city proposal that has come forward. On this issue, there's obviously a little bit of a difference. The Assembly recommended, you know, going with the governor's approach, but, you know, an openness to reforms in lieu of elimination. And the city's put together some possible reforms, and I want to make sure we cover that as well as the proposal. So, Mr. Cohen.
Sure. I'll summarize our proposal in a minute, but let me just say the big city mayor suggestion, the administration has not received any formal proposals. So we've certainly seen and heard pieces of proposals. Your agenda outlines one of them, but the details seem to be changing on a day-to-day basis, and the administration hasn't received anything specific. So on that, I'd suggest we keep our comments fairly high level. Just to recap the administration's proposal, it is to end redevelopment agencies beginning in the budget year, but preserve all of their existing debt obligations, that all existing redevelopment debt would continue to be funded. There's an increment of an estimated $1.9 billion that would be freed up by not having redevelopment agencies extend and add new obligations. And going forward, the administration's goal for that $1.9 billion is to get it back into the hands of local governments as general purpose money so that they can make decisions on what is their top priority. So that could mean in schools there would be roughly $1 billion more for education and improving our classroom instruction. On the city and county side, it could be police, fire. Cities can continue to use their general purpose money to fund these economic development and redevelopment type activities. Obviously, we are also seeking to balance the budget. So in the first year, on a one-time only basis, we would redirect most of that $1.9 billion, $1.7 billion to help balance the budget by paying for a share of trial courts and Medi-Cal. In terms of the big city mayor proposal as it's outlined in your agenda or other variations, clearly one of our biggest concerns is simply that this is going to be a continuation of borrowing money to help balance the budget. Anytime you extend redevelopment agencies, you're extending the general fund subsidy for redevelopment. And just if it needs to be clarified, when we talk about a general fund subsidy for redevelopment, that's through schools and the loss of school property taxes. So it's As of today, redevelopment costs the state general fund roughly $2 billion a year. Under our proposal, ceasing redevelopment agencies, as debts are paid off, we would go back to a normal process over time where that would not be, that general fund subsidy would not be there. To the extent that you're looking at proposals that extend redevelopment agencies' life, you're obviously extending that general fund subsidy. The other key area to look at is the borrowing itself, a securitization plan. We're not sure that it passes a number of legal tests, in particular Proposition 58, which restricted the state from borrowing to balance its budget, and that seems to fly in the face of that. So basically, just to close on the legal question, you know, a proposal that attempts to work within the legal confines of Proposition 22 is severely limited. However, our proposal, by eliminating redevelopment agencies, we think is perfectly constitutionally valid, because all of the constitutional provisions dealing with redevelopment today are dealing with restrictions on what the state can do or tell redevelopment agencies to do, and it's all presumed on the notion that the legislature established redevelopment by statute and therefore can eliminate redevelopment agencies by statute. Finally, just in terms of economic development at the local level, redevelopment is really designed to try to move economic development from one place to another within a city's jurisdictions or within a county's jurisdictions. Those types of things may be perfectly valid at the local level, but from a statewide perspective, there's not a compelling state interest. And that's why we're suggesting that economic development responsibilities be much more focused at the local level. We are proposing a constitutional amendment that would make it easier for cities and counties to continue to undertake redevelopment activities, but on their own dime, not on the state's and schools' money.
Thank you. Mr. Taylor, you want to, or Somali?
We concur with the Department of Finance in terms of the cost of redevelopment to the state being in excess of $2 billion. This is because schools don't get the property tax revenues that otherwise they would have gotten, and the state has to backfill the schools. We also concur with the Department of Finance that there's no evidence, no reliable evidence, that redevelopment results in overall higher level of statewide economic activity. In terms of the city counter proposal, we haven't seen it in any detail. We've heard different discussions regarding it, and so we cannot comment on it in detail. In years past, though, we have looked at similar types of proposals and generally have found that they result in very high long-term costs for the state, because the state has an enormous fiscal interest in the orderly resolution of completion of redevelopment projects. And then lastly, in terms of the administration's proposal, there is a policy question that you will have regarding if redevelopment agencies end, how to treat these increased property taxes that would be going to schools, whether or not they should be treated as property taxes and fed right into the existing Prop 98 model, or whether they should be kept outside of Proposition 98 and provided as kind of a supplement to school districts that happen to be in redevelopment areas or in counties that had redevelopment projects. That's a secondary policy question, though, regarding the treatment of those education of those local property tax revenues. In general, we think the governor's proposal merits consideration. Redevelopment is a very large and growing state cost.
Great, thank you, Mr. Emerson, followed by Mr. Leno.
Yeah, Mr. Cohen, why are you treating the education dollars outside of 98? What was the policy decision for that?
The policy decision goes back to our discussion earlier about the drop in Proposition 98 funding that's occurred, and the goal of the administration was to try to get money back into the hands of school at a faster rate than Proposition 98 would do on its own. So it's kind of, as Proposition 98 returns to its long-term level over a number of years, this money would, on the natural, start phasing out as the redevelopment obligations are paid off. So it's trying to, until Proposition 98 gets back to its so its ultimate level, it providing a supplement to school districts.
Okay, I'm confused, but that's all right. What's in the constitutional amendment with regard to the voter threshold for local governments to do redevelopment?
Sure, and I should have clarified that constitutional amendment we're looking for 2012. It's not connected with the constitutional amendment we were just speaking about. But what we're proposing is a 55% vote threshold rather than the current two-thirds for one of two things, either issuing bonds that are for redevelopment type activities or raising taxes, particularly the sales tax and the gas tax for redevelopment type activities. So in essence, if the local community would want to continue these redevelopment activities using their own dollars and their own commitment of funds, then they would have a slightly easier time getting that approved.
Yeah. Even though it's on the ballot in 2012, it is connected to this your plan.
Absolutely, it's part of the administration's proposal.
Yeah, right. And how does that? How do you justify that based on Prop 26 from the last election?
Well, we'd be going back to the. To the voters and asking them to basically do they think economic development activities merit an exception from the existing special fund tax rule?
Mr. Leno followed by Mr. Lowenthal.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Ms. O'Malley, you concluded your comments by stating that the share property tax used by redevelopment continues to grow. I think it's gone from about 2% to 12% over the years. Do you see anything that restricts it in future years? Might it grow to 15 or 20? Is there any ceiling to it?
There's no ceiling to it. In fact, we've got a couple counties that more than one out of four property taxes collected in the county goes to a redevelopment agency and not to the cities or county or special districts or schools. Cities face enormous fiscal incentives. They're very attractive to create redevelopment project areas. Land that's under a redevelopment project, cities normally get 2 to 3 times as much property tax revenues, even after accounting for the housing and the pass-throughs and everything else. So there's an enormous fiscal advantage for cities to place very large areas under redevelopment. If you look at redevelopment throughout the nation, in California's redevelopment program dwarfs all the other states. And it's not because we're so much more blighted. It's because we place an enormous fiscal incentive on cities, primarily cities, but also to some extent counties, to place land under redevelopment because they capture a very large share of the property tax that way. So no, we've been seeing significant growth in the percentage of land and the percentage of assessed valuation that's been placed under redevelopment. It used to be redevelopment projects were 10, maybe 100 acres. Now we have some of them that are well over 20,000 acres of land. And that direction has been continuing over the, especially over the last 10, 20 years.
I want to get to the 10 cities proposal, mm-hmm. which I know may not be in final form. You said you hadn't received anything definitive. In any case, mm-hmm. you're familiar with some of the bigger sure. themes in it. Mr. Cohn has said that he thinks there is still concern with both Prop 22 and Prop 58. Can you comment on that?
I have heard that the city-county proposal includes going to the voters in to get permission to make this modification. I'm not certain if that is correct. Presumably, if they went to the voters, they could get permission to waive aside the provisions of Prop 22 and Prop 1A. If you don't go to the voters, then it's very difficult for me to imagine how the cities could provide tax increment revenues and provide it to the state for the state to securitize these revenues. That appears to be exactly opposite what the voters required under Proposition 22 just last November.
And with regard to Prop 58? And the issue of bonding to balance the budget?
I mean, there's clearly an issue there, as Mr. Cohen said. Can't say for sure these aren't state revenues per se. They're not state tax revenues. So I suppose someone could make the case that it doesn't violate 58, but I think you definitely have an issue.
Okay. And then one of the selling points, as has been made to me, is with regard to whether the $1.7 billion figure is a solid figure, that they have done an analysis that pegs it closer to about $860 million. Have you looked at that? And specific, that being their analysis?
We looked at their analysis that estimated $861 million, and we found some very serious problems with that analysis. It's kind of a technical kind of thing, and it's difficult to walk you through. But they included things, for example, for two cities, estimating that their amount of debt that is due and payable, and they specify the dollar amounts. But when we look at what the redevelopment agencies say are their total revenues, they're indicating that these debts that are due and payable that year are greater than all their revenues, which doesn't make an awful lot of sense. When we take a look at that model and say, okay, those two cities appear to overstate their due and payable debts, and we pulled them out of the analysis, then their entire result flops, and actually they end up generating more than the $1.7 billion that the administration estimates. So there's a lot of sort of technical issues regarding their proposal and regarding their analysis that really just don't hold up upon deeper looking. We have chatted with the developers of this analysis last week and indicated our concerns and welcomed any feedback that could help us understand their analysis in a different light, and we haven't gotten any feedback.
And then lastly, have you reviewed the administration's $1.7 billion figure?
We have looked at it. We also say that there are questions with it. We cannot corroborate this number. We do not know for certain that you would get $1.7 billion in 12 months. But there's a couple other things to think about. The administration's proposal looks only at the amount of tax increment revenues. Redevelopment agencies get money other than tax increment, where they get assessments, they get some tax revenues. They have some land that they can sell also to pay debt. There are some other revenues that the administration didn't consider in terms of paying some existing debts. There are some alternative sources of revenues. The other thing to keep in mind is that there is about $2.5 billion worth of unspent low and mod income housing fund, which perhaps could be borrowed against on a one-time basis if, in fact, the $1.7 billion didn't materialize in 1 year. And then lastly, just in terms of the $1.7 billion, now, say, for example, that at the end of the day there was only $1.5 billion. The redevelopment tax increment is annual. So if you were to look at, take your horizon and not be just 12 months for the fiscal year, but to consider it over 15 months or 16 months, perhaps then there would be the $1.7 billion. But anyway, just in terms of the administration's analysis, they didn't consider all the revenues. They left out a lot. They also didn't consider borrowing from the low and mod income housing fund, which we understand there's over $2.5 billion sitting there. And then lastly, it's looking at only at 12 months, and there's nothing magical that it only has to be a 12-month period. One could envision lengthening the period for which the revenues could be redirected if necessary.
So for the purpose of this conversation, just leaving out the low-mod housing fund, which might have some of its own controversy to it, but including assessments, land sales,
interest,
rent payments,
interest earnings,
all of
reserves,
that.
Right.
Expanding the universe to that, the 1.7 might be a pretty good average number.
It appears more reasonable. We're still looking at the numbers.
Sure. Very good. Thank you.
Mr. Lowenthal, followed by myself.
One is just a comment after watching this process now going through with the finances and the governor's proposal to eliminate redevelopment and then the proposal by the big city mayors, which we'll be, I think, discussing in greater detail later. One of the things that strikes me, if we do not do the total elimination, is that we have no real data. We have no standardized reporting from agencies. I mean, I'm just really shocked that we can't find out how much money really is there, what monies are being used for. Every city is not reporting back. And I'm not blaming the cities now for that or the state, but we have a very convoluted system, it seems to me, to figure out, you know, where. And some of the data goes back to 2007-08 that they're using because we have no up-to-date data on how much tax increment money. So I'm just really surprised that we don't really are not able at a quick glance to really find out how much money there is in redevelopment. And so I'd like to hear comments on that. I mean, that's what's so shocking when the cities say that there's $861 million. And you look at the numbers, and the numbers from each city, they include different data. Each city throws in different amounts of data that they report to the state. So I'm just very surprised that this has gone on this long without really understanding just what is out there and what is not out there. And I'd like some comment. And the other point is right now the state is backfilling because of Prop 98. The school portion that the tax increment money is going on. But we are not backfilling the amount of money to counties and to cities and to to special districts. So if the administration's proposal goes on, there will be a decided increase in that amount of money going back to the local, which we're not now providing them for. And I'd like some response to that, too.
You're perfectly right in terms of the data. They are very, very limited. The document that everyone points to in terms of redevelopment agencies is the statement of indebtedness. But what many of you learned through the various hearings that you've had on redevelopment agencies is agencies compile their statement of indebtedness in very different ways. You have a large number of cities and county redevelopment agencies that put on the statement of indebtedness all their housing debt, including housing and debt that they would incur in the future. And you have other redevelopment agencies that only list on their statement of indebtedness their current responsibilities for funding housing. The numbers are all over the map, and so it makes it very difficult to give you kind of a real assessment as to how much money really is there. The way redevelopment agencies work, redevelopment law works in California, is the day that a redevelopment project is created, the frozen base is established. And then for 50 years afterwards, all the growth in the redevelopment project goes to the redevelopment agency. There are some requirements for housing and some for pass-throughs, but for 50 years, that future stream of revenues goes to the redevelopment agency, and the state doesn't have an awful lot of authority to make modifications of that, and we don't even have very good information regarding the expenditures.
And let me just comment on the second part of your question, because it's at the core of the governor's proposal that going forward, starting in 2012-13, there would be roughly $1.9 billion back in the hands of local governments for general purposes for their highest priority based on those boards' decisions. About $1 billion of that is schools. Another $900 million would be cities, counties, and special districts, general purpose money that they could spend on core public services.
Thank you. A quick follow-up on something Mr. Leno was talking about the, you know, the growth rate going to potentially to 20%. One of the aspects of the big city proposal was that they put a cap on it. They said, okay, you just can't. Isn't that one way that you could deal with that, is by basically picking a number and putting a cap? And if not that cap, what other caps could you use?
I'm not familiar with that proposal, so it's very difficult to speak
just
to
just
it.
But
in concept, there are many other states that limit how much cities and counties can place under redevelopment. The South Dakota model comes to mind. They say that their cities can only put 10% of total assessed valuation under redevelopment, no more than 10%, and they limit it for 15 years, and they don't allow the agency to redirect the school share of the property tax. That's a model, okay? There are other states that allow longer periods but also don't allow the redirection of school revenues. There are other states that allow redirection of other local agencies' revenues but only upon their consent. They would have to get the consent of the counties or the consent of the schools. So there's a variety of different models. You could place a limit on aggregate amount of assessed valuation under redevelopment. You could limit the period. You could require that the overlapping local agencies consent to the proposal. So there's a variety of ways that you could. Most of those proposals, though, would affect future redevelopment projects. So if you were to change the law going forward, it's very difficult to make modifications to a variety of existing redevelopment projects because they've been set up under a set of laws that were in place when they were created.
Thank you. Mr. Nielsen, followed by Mr. Huff.
The governor's proposal, at the least, has caused some focus on an area that I think is been out of control for some time, and I'm glad that it has.
Been out of control?
I would say out of control. Eminent domain, very loose definition of the designations of blight, and this is a time to, I think, say whoa, if not get rid of the redevelopment agencies, at least to say whoa. And is it not in order to try to restrain some of that vast accumulation of these increments? That seems like an awful lot of money that we're squiring away, and further then to redirect some of that to local government. Shouldn't that be a part of our, if we're going to examine and change this, a couple of those two elements?
Yeah, I think that's why the administration has proposed it, and we generally have felt like it merits your consideration. Mm-hmm. I think the one issue on the school funding, I just want to come back to, though, if I could, Assemblyman, Senator Emerson raised it. We would strongly urge you just to have the dollars flow through in their current arrangement back to schools, not be an add-on to Prop 98. The administration has suggested, well, this will help them as they work back their maintenance factor. You know, we could get back to where schools have a lot more funding within a short number of years if we have a spike in revenues or whatever. This supplement would be on top of that, and you would, in effect, be taking money away from the non-school part of your budget. Health and social services, criminal justice, higher education. So if you do the governor's proposal, we would strongly suggest that you just let the money flow back to local governments, including schools, under the current arrangement. It should not be a supplement to 98. But again, we think the proposal does have merit for the reason that you mentioned.
But maybe not to the extent of eliminating them entirely, but now sort of reforming or changing business as usual?
As Ms. O'Malley said, you have lots of options available to you.
Yeah. It should be a fruitful discussion.
Okay, and Ms. Skinner had a follow-up, and then Mr. Huff.
I just wanted to ask you a question regarding your description of, say, a South Dakota model. Is it your sense that we would need to, in effect, eliminate redevelopment as it is now and then instate something like that? Or is there, when you said, you made a reference to you can't change what's existing, so are you saying that it has to be eliminated and then restructured? Or why couldn't it be restructured now?
I don't see why. I don't see any limitations under Prop 22 for limiting in the terms of future redevelopment projects. So if the legislature were to modify redevelopment law and say henceforth any new project areas must meet these types of criteria, I don't see any limitations under Prop 22. So I think the legislature could do that at the same time of maintaining existing community redevelopment law. I say that with a little bit of a question, but I don't see anything under Prop 22 that would prohibit the legislature from continuing existing redevelopment law and then creating a modified one on a going forward basis.
So it's a Prop 22 issue? or Prop 22 potential.
Prop 22 interplays with the legislature's ability
to
redirect some of these revenues and use them as a budget solution.
Okay,
we're going to have Mr. Huff and then Ms. Harkey, and then I'm going to end the questions for now, unless somebody has a burning follow-up, which I'll entertain, of course, and then we'll take a break at that point. So Mr. Huff and then Mr. Harkey. Ms. Harkey.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Mr. Cohen. Quick question for you. With this proposal, is either Medi-Cal or the trial courts being reduced?
This particular piece, no. It's using the tax dollars to replace general fund dollars. We do have cut proposals in both of those areas, but if we're talking just redevelopment, the redevelopment proposal doesn't affect their operations.
Okay, so back to my comment earlier, why would you characterize this as a reduction in your budget proposal as opposed to other solution?
It's a reduction to local economic development activities. It's not a reduction to a state program.
Right.
And I think part of the thing that's underlying our realignment proposal and all of this thing is that state and local finances have become intertwined over the last number of decades. And the way that our budget displays these things also has become intertwined. And so we chose to show expenditure reductions for two reasons. One is that they are cutting, in this case, redevelopment. And then two, just from a budgeting standpoint, it is reducing state general fund spending.
Well, and you're sending it down a local level for them to spend. So it really hasn't cut the scope of anything. It's actually done an end run around Prop 98, because as you raise taxes at the local level, you don't have to do this Prop 98 funding. I mean, I understand that.
And on the realignment piece of things, the $5.9 billion, we do show that as on the revenue side of things, because there's not really a programmatic cut to these programs. It is the benefit to the budget is on the revenue side by having an additional $5.9 billion of reduced spending, but it's because we're extending taxes.
And to the degree that you know, you've scored $1.7 billion, the, you know, there's some question about how much is actually there, $807 million, $200 million. I hear all kinds of numbers. That doesn't seem to be a standard methodology. We don't know what it is. But that's a one-time solution. How do you take care of this next year? Isn't this just pushing the, we like to use that term, kicking the can down the road?
Sure. I think if it was the entire budget was surrounded by $25, $26 billion of this, absolutely. However, you've got to take this one-time solution in the context of the overall budget problem and the overall level of solutions we've proposed. So combining our we have a current year deficit that we're going to end the current year with about an $8 billion deficit. And then the upcoming year, if we did nothing, we would outspend our revenues by about $17 billion. So the way I tend to think about it is that our one-time solutions are really a credit against our one-time carry-in deficit of that $8 billion. So as long as your one-time solutions don't exceed basically that $8 billion level, and your ongoing solutions are in that $17 to $20 billion range, it's perfectly appropriate to have a mix of one-time and ongoing solutions. And the way we sort of reflect that, if we've done the right math, is by looking at our multi-year projection. Mm-hmm. And under our forecast, we're balanced in both, in all 3 years, 12-13, 2013-14, and 2014-15.
If you put your thumb on the scale, you can balance about anything. You use the term intertwined. Contortionist might be a better word.
Granted.
You know, and I appreciate that. The thing that frustrates me in this whole thing is, once again, we the state are looking to balance, you know, our budget on the backs of local government. They continue to push back, put things on the ballot. They've got a really good track record on that. We are very creative in finding yet other avenues to go back after that pot of money in different ways. And I just think we ought to be looking for a win-win solution out of this. There's different iterations the cities are coming up with. Let's find a way to actually work alongside of them instead of cross purposes with them. I think we'll all do better. And I have no problem with extending project areas or whatever else. I do believe that redevelopment and enterprise zones are economic tools, maybe not the only thing out there, but for some, they're very effective. Let's reform it rather than just throwing it all out. You know, those are my two thoughts on it, but, you know, it's at least part of what we're looking at, but I certainly can't support this. I think it's ripe for litigation. That creates uncertainty. We've heard in the beginning that anything with uncertainty and problem this size just makes it, you know, ready to collapse down the road. So,
okay, Ms. Harkey, and then we're gonna break for the day.
Well, I wanted to make a few comments and ask a question, but one of the problems that I think we're going to face with the big cities proposal, and I know we have some big cities people sitting up here on the dais, is that cities can go bankrupt. And so if they run into problems and they file for bankruptcy, how does that affect the securitization of our debt? I think it's a slippery slope there to ask them to securitize debt at the state level. And that brings me to my other point, that I'm very, very concerned that we are looking to local government to backfill us, and that we are creating havoc with their own local economies, worse than what they're having right now. And I've never been a big redevelopment fan, but I have seen where it's worked beautifully. And provided in some areas where they get that low tax distribution, because, you know, as you know, after Prop 13, the monies came to the state, everything kind of got shifted around. And I'm still trying to work through that maze to find out how. But I do know Orange County and many areas are still considered rural for a tax allocation. So in some of these areas, they have been able to, in San Diego County, huge, some of these areas, they've been able to keep a little more money local to do local items. And I think it's been very, very important to them. I am very concerned about the eminent domain concerns, and I think that we can possibly work with that. My question to Ms. O'Malley is, I'm still not clear on the Prop 22. If we were to reform, put a package of reforms for redevelopment, such as more revenue sharing, eliminate the powers of eminent domain, require voter approvals for issuance of bonds, require RDAs to be subject to referendum, prohibit them from taking on new debt, et cetera, and prohibit maybe extending the project areas, and restrict maybe the amounts of tax increment. Could we, in fact, in light of Prop 22, could we apply limitations on the existing redevelopment agencies?
Absent going back to the voters, you could do a lot of those things except for the fiscal ones. You couldn't do the revenue sharing, and you couldn't do the modification of the tax increment, absent going back to the voters. Some of the other provisions that you discussed in terms of modification of eminent domain, et cetera, and a referendum, you could do that. But Prop 22 locks in place the current tax increment allocation structure and guarantees redevelopment agencies those revenues.
Right. I just would like to point out, I think it really, once again, we're saying let the voters decide, and the voters did decide on this, regardless of how we feel about this now or felt anywhere about redevelopment. And it's just plugging a one-time hole for us, but it is actually flying in the face of what the voters did decide, which is not to tell the state to balance its own budget and not take any more from the cities. So this, to me, is not a pro-redevelopment or non-redevelopment issue. It is simply a matter of what are we doing at the state level that's impacting local communities that have counted on these funds, that have budgeted for them. We took them a couple years or last year. They've said, no, don't take them anymore. And so now we're going to just get rid of them and eliminate them. It seems a little big brotherish to me. And I'm very, very concerned that we're going to be doing damage at the local level with the local economies without a lot of forethought up here. We need to figure out how to make this work without just stealing their money again, because it's a one-time pop. Once we disband them, we can't go back to the trough again. It's gone. And we did it last year. Do it this year. Take it away. I've got a problem. And I think it's been mentioned that there's a problem with the 1.7. Is it really there? What do we do about affordable housing mandates, you know, and reducing the LAO said reductions to, or excuse me, the Department of Finance said the reductions to local economic activity. That's exactly what I'm talking about. There, I think there will be reductions right now. I think people are hanging on at the local level. So I'm very concerned with this, and I look forward to fleshing some of these things out. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Ms. Harkey. And we certainly are going to spend more time on this proposal. At this point, I'm going to adjourn us for today. We've made some progress and spent a lot of time. We're going to come back tomorrow at 11 a.m., and then on Friday we'll come back at 10 a.m. There was some confusion about the room. We will be in this room on both days. So that's all been cleared out, and we'll revisit all the issues. And I'm going to ask, you know, Department of Finance, LAO, to take a close look at the city's proposal in the interim, so we can talk more specifically about that to try to get a handle on that. And with that, thank you all very much. That concludes our tomorrow at 10 a.m. and Friday at 11 a.m. Tomorrow is at 11. Friday is at 10. Tomorrow is at 11. Friday is at 10. I said it wrong the second time. Yes. Tomorrow at 11. Friday at 10. Thank you.